وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. My brothers and sisters, when a person loses a spouse, especially when they've been very close, it's a very difficult time. Life changes and so much happens suddenly, and everything feels like a huge burden on the shoulder. There are days of sadness and sorrow, days of crying, days of missing your spouse and so on. So generally, Allah has kept a period for the women known as al-iddah. Al-iddah meaning the waiting period, or to a certain extent, a mourning period. Now, the mourning period is generally 3 days, but when it comes to a wife, Allah says, we know we created you. We know how your system works. We know what you need. We don't want you to marry immediately after the death of your spouse. We want you to wait for a period of 4 months and 10 days minimum. Why? Why should I? Well, you should, because Allah is telling you that we want you to do this. There will be healing in that time. Nobody will be able to take advantage of you. You will begin to see things much more clearer. You will be able to wind down the estate of your spouse. You will be able to adjust to this new life of yours. And you'll be able to protect yourself from being taken advantage of during your vulnerable time. So Allah tells you, we want you to heal holistically, fully. You'll be able to replug with Allah. You'll be able to focus on what you want to do in the future. Do you really want to marry? Is it worth it? Yes, it may be. So Allah says, if you're ready, after 4 months and 10 days, you can start taking the steps if you want. And if you don't, it's not compulsory. But Allah says, that period of iddah is a blessing from us for you. It's not a prison sentence. And this is why a lot of the times women are made to feel that the iddah is a prison sentence where you're not allowed to come out of the house at all. Well, for anything you consider a need or necessity, you're allowed to come out of the house. Let's get that correct. For anything you consider a need or a necessity, you're allowed to come out of the house. Allah doesn't want you to socialize outside of the house. So to go out for a social purpose is not considered a necessity, because Allah wants to protect you. Imagine your husband just died, and the very next day or a few days later, you're just partying, enjoying with your friends. I mean, you need to be protected. Allah wants to protect you. No one must point finger at you that you had any role to play in the death of your spouse. This is just one of the examples. It has happened to people, even from our own communities, where people begin to point dirty fingers, accusing their spouses of having had a role to play in the death of the one who passed on. Crazy people, but Allah wants to protect you from that. So Allah tells you, do you know what? Take it in your stride. You go through this period of healing. That's what it is. It's more healing than anything else. Grieving. Allah allows you the time to grieve, especially if you were very close. It's not all about just focusing on whether you're expecting a child or not. That can be sorted out in a minute. But it's more about something beyond that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand His blessings in everything. Like I said, it's not a prison sentence. If need be, you may go out. Sometimes, even if you're claustrophobic, and even if you're living in a very small home where it's just a room and your yard is not good enough, because sometimes in some countries you have a big yard. You can come out in the yard and you can enjoy yourself. And sometimes you don't have that yard. You're living in a high rise. Do you know that if you really feel psychologically, you feel the need to go out in order to just freshen yourself, to gain your sanity and maintain it, you may do so. Don't let people tell you that that is totally prohibited when you're struggling and psychologically it's affecting your mind and your entire system. You just need a breather to get out of the house, and here people are telling you it's totally prohibited. You can't move. You can't. Relax. Take it easy. Ask those who know. They will guide you. Subhanallah. It's not a prison sentence. Not at all. So don't make it seem like you've done something wrong, so you're in a jail. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. I want to move on to some beautiful hope that Allah has given us in the Quran when He mentions a story of David and Goliath, Dawood and Jalut. Dawood alayhi salam, the messenger of Allah, the prophet and the king. He was a great man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how at one point in his life, he faced Goliath, who was huge, and there seemed to be no chance of him overpowering Goliath or Jalut. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and his might decided that Dawood would actually overpower Goliath. So Allah says, وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ وَآتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. And Dawood overcame and actually killed Jalut, Goliath. And Allah says, we gave David kingdom and wisdom, prophethood, and so much more. Allah gave them so much, subhanAllah. Now, if you look at this, the next verse, or the previous verse, in fact, verse number 249, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَمْ مِنْ فِيَةٍ قَلِيلًا غَلَبَتْ فِيَةً كَثِيرًا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. How many times has a small group overpowered a big group? How many times has the smaller power overcome the bigger power? SubhanAllah. Allah says, all this is in the hands of Allah. You need to have hope. You need to try your best and you need to give it your full, whatever you can, and then just leave it in the hands of Allah. Allah will grant you strength. I know, subhanAllah, some of you who are football crazy must be thinking, yeah, well, my team is not that big a team, but we can win, subhanAllah. I think the message we're delivering is far broader than just a game of football. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. There is a lot of healing in a verse of the Quran which needs to be repeated every single day, morning and evening. In fact, after every prayer, we're taught to repeat this one verse. If you repeat it, you will be protected by Allah, and Allah will heal you, guard you, guide you. Allah will strengthen you. Allah has kept a lot of strength in this particular verse of a different nature. So we are taught to repeat it. Just by reading it, Allah protects you from shaitan bothering you. What is this verse? It is verse number 255 of Surah Al-Baqarah, known as Ayah Al-Kursi. Ayat al-Kursi, the verse of the pedestal. So, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. Allah, there is none worthy of worship besides Him, the ever-living, the all-alert, all-alive, subhanAllah. And this verse continues. It's a nice long verse. But, my brothers and sisters, the protection in that verse that Allah has kept is something we can never do without. Please read this verse every morning and evening and after every farad prayer, at least once. It's supposed to be thrice in the morning, thrice in the evening. But even if you were to do it once, it will calm you. Learn it if you don't know it. You must learn it and read it melodiously for the sake of Allah. Try and get its meaning and try and sync your recitation with the meaning in order to add an extra impact. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the truth is manifest, the falsehood is manifest, and Allah will guide you to tread a path based on His guidance and what you are searching for. When you are looking for something, Allah will give it to you. When you're looking for the truth, when you're searching for the truth, Allah will show it to you. For as long as you're genuine and you're trying your best, Allah will always guide you. Now, after Ayatul Kursi, and it has a beautiful story that comes with it, where the Prophet ﷺ tells Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu that Shaytan told you the truth when he told you that Ayatul Kursi has the power to keep me and my progeny away from you and will protect you from me. But Shaytan is a liar, so don't believe him. Don't believe Shaytan. Do you know the beautiful words, Sadaqaka wa huwa kadhub? This time he told you the truth, but he's a liar. SubhanAllah. You know, when I think of those words of the Prophet ﷺ, I tell myself, amazing how beautifully it's worded. I have so much of hope in the mercy of Allah. He's confirming to me that this verse will keep me protected from shaitan. Shaitan himself acknowledged that, yeah, it's a powerful verse. I agree. And Allah says, Or the Prophet ﷺ says to Abu Huraira, watch out, this guy told you the truth right now, but he's generally a liar. Don't believe everything he says. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from shaitan and grant us all the best of this world, our offspring, our progeny, our loved ones. Ameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.
Wa nunazzilu min al-Qur'ani ma huwa shifa'un wa rahmatun lil-mu'minin.